received an email from the online computer testing system Quest. For those of you that don't know what Quest is, it's a quick online quiz that you answer on at any time to your convenience. I think the cutoff date for this quest is set at Saturday at 6 p.m. The test is normally 45 minutes, but should take you 10 minutes to do it. So it is for grades. It counts 8% of the grade. There will be about 3 or 4 of these quests coming in the next 2-3 weeks. And that all that there are is they're short questions for you to practice for the final exam. They take you no time. If you've been coming to class, you don't need to do anything. Actually, you just answer the questions online, and it's done in about 10 to 15 minutes.
Is there a mobile currently during the class? So like, that's not the question.
It's always based on what we've just covered.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions on that? Okay, so you've received that email, click on the link, and then log in and answer the questions. You've got 45 minutes, you cannot come back to it. So once you start the question, you've got 45 minutes to finish it up in that time frame. So let's just quickly review where we were last time. We were looking at isotherms, and we had last class was basically looking at two examples of using these isotherms. And we had isotherms of various shapes, and here I just want to illustrate what happens to an isotherm when we change temperature in the system. So an isotherm, by definition, is the relationship between what's on the horizontal axis, pressure, partial pressure of A, or the concentration of A, and it's telling me what the relationship between that concentration is and the concentration on the adsorbents. So we have typically these sort of Langmuir or Cornwallis-shaped isotherms. This is at the particular temperature at which you're going to operate at, the adsorption temperature. Later on, what you might do is change the temperature in that plant bed to a lower value or a higher value, and that isotherm will shift. Here we see, for example, this isotherm changes location for the same system. Now all that we do is we move to a higher temperature, so we call that TDES for the desorption mode. We'll increase the temperature in the system, the isotherm changes, and in fact what you'll notice is that this isotherm moves lower. And that's expected. When you increase the temperature in the system, that equilibrium constant between the forward reaction and the reverse reaction that you looked at last time, that changes. That rate constants change, that equilibrium constant changes, and we can now move to the desorption.
To get back just to the quest, they have to be actually done individually.
They're done individually. Okay, so adsorption isotherms shift with temperature. At lower temperatures, these isotherms move up. At higher temperatures, the isotherms move down, indicating that exactly what we expect. If we move to higher temperatures, we cannot adsorb as much material onto that solid phase anymore. Material, in fact, will start to desorb off the isotherm. So the way you can see that is if you're operating at a given concentration of Ca, for example, over here, when you're operating at this temperature, you can load that much adsorbent, or that much A onto the adsorbent. If I increase the temperature in the system, then that equilibrium shifts. I can only load that much material onto the adsorbent. So my concentration loaded onto that solid phase drops. What that means is, in fact, that species A starts to move off the solid surface and goes back into the bulk phase. So what we're going to look at today is understanding what happens in these adsorbents. We've got a packed bed here filled with adsorbent. So that's the X region of the bed is filled with solid phase adsorbent. And in fact, what I'm going to have you do is, for the next 2 minutes, work with the person next to you. So you have to do this in pairs. One of you will look at the left-hand side, one of you will look at the right-hand side. So decide who's going to be the left and who's going to be the right. Look at these figures on this slide 34, look at the figure on slide 35 for 2 minutes. Understand what's going on your side of the picture. The other person will understand what's going on their side of the picture, and then you explain to each other before I explain back to you. Okay, so take 2-3 minutes and understand what's going on in this diagram. You're going to teach each other. Explain it to the person next to you. What couldn't you explain to the person?
On the other slide, that theta s. Theta s.
Okay. Couldn't explain what theta s is? Those were the only two things you couldn't explain?
What's the difference between theta s and theta e?
Theta s, theta e, what is the difference there between them? Anything else?
And theta b.
Oh, I just understand everything? No, seriously, like what, I would like to spend my time focusing on things that you don't understand so that I don't explain things that are obvious, right? So anything else that's confusing here?
Yes. On that first slide, the bottom two diagrams on the left, they look like really similar. I wasn't really sure what the difference between who is data. Data equals data, data equals data.
Okay, so what's the difference between plot B and C? Okay. Anything else? Danielle, you had something?
Yeah, I'm trying to, like, the relationship between CAF, CAS, and CA, like, and then how do you, like, compare them with those, like, the feed analysis of adsorbent and the analysis of the effluent, like, how do those relate?
Okay, so all the notation of the CAs and the various superscripts and subscripts. Okay, so let's, this diagram is what actually happens in an adsorb. Yeah, if you, no? No questions? No, nothing yet? Okay.
Proceeding not, is that, and that kind of CAS not, is that supposed to be zero, which is normally drawn on the line, or is it just supposed to represent like really, really small?
Okay, yeah, we'll talk about the CAs in the notation. So, these diagrams are what happens in actual practice. Let's talk about what an ideal system might be, and in that way you can appreciate what's going on in actual practice. So think of yourself standing on the feed end to the adsorber. So here's the pack bed, and you're feeding material with concentration CAF. So there's a certain amount of material A in that feed that you'd like to remove. Let's say 100 parts per million, or 1% of that feed is the material you would like to remove. That's what we call CAF. It's the concentration of A in the feed. So that's what's coming into the adsorber. Now, one way you can look at it is consider what you see coming out on the other side. So here's my packed bed. I'm feeding material with CAF, and leaving here in the other side is CA. Concentration of A. And you can observe that concentration of A. That's very easy to do. We can put a spectrophotometer here on this piece of the pipe, and we can very easily track concentration of A for liquid phases or gas phase systems. Now, what you should see standing on this side is almost no CA, or zero. Okay, basically, undetectable amounts of CA coming in. So you're feeding stuff in here. What's happening to it?
It's
being adsorbed. Okay. Now you're feeding here at a constant rate. Let's say QF, some flow rate Q. It's being adsorbed. If you could take a look at the adsorbent and measure that concentration on the adsorbent, CAS. So CAS is the concentration of A on the adsorbent. Initially, when that bed is being regenerated, so it's fresh adsorbent in there, at time zero, all this adsorbent is fresh, there's nothing loaded on it, we call that CAS naught. So at time zero, there's nothing on it, or there might be some residual amount from the previous run that's left over. So we call that CAS naught, some initial concentration of A on the adsorbent at time zero. So it's usually zero or close to zero. Now in the ideal case, what will happen is this material coming in will start to get adsorbed. And so you can conceptually consider a vertical line like that, where everything to the left is material that's being adsorbed onto the adsorbent. So time progresses, and at the next point in time, this line moves forward. So we call this the wavefront. Now, is that wavefront going to move at a constant velocity or a changing velocity? So I'm feeding material at a constant flow rate. Does this wavefront move at a linear rate? Or does it move faster and faster and faster, or slow? Does it slow down over time?
Slower because the material is being adsorbed.
Yeah, it's slower because it has time to get used to it. stuff ahead of it is still being absorbed.
Depends on the cross-sectional area in your bed. If it's constant cross-section, it will move at a constant speed.
Okay. So it's a cylindrical bed. You're feeding at a constant flow rate Q. The ideal situation is that this wave runs as a vertical line. There's no material moving faster, no material moving slower. This wave front moves at a constant rate, at a constant velocity. And we can calculate what that velocity is, in fact. I'll show you what we can compute that velocity as in a minute. So let's take time, progresses, this wave front moves. Okay, so you're loading up this bed, and then you're standing here, and then suddenly you go from seeing nothing to seeing something. What do you see? You see nothing, and then it steps up. What value does it step up to? CAS, CAF, CA naught, CAS naught, CAF. Okay? So at the outlet, you'll suddenly step up from nothing, zero, or approximately zero, let's say, to some value CAF. And it will literally be like that in the ideal case. That CA, this material A, is being adsorbed onto the bed, and then you've used up 100% of the bed. Now there's no more adsorbent left, there's no more empty space for A to be adsorbed onto, and what's leaving is exactly what you're feeding. Okay, there's no more capacity to adsorb. Mona, no? Don't get it?
If you're trying to adsorb A,
yeah.
If your concentration leaving is the same as the concentration coming in, won't that mean nothing will
absorb? Absolutely. Nothing is happening. Once you've used up this adsorbent, there's no more capacity for it to adsorb anymore, A. So essentially, this just becomes a glorified pipe, feeding stuff in and stuff leaves it there.
Does the wave front correspond to the beginning of the mass transfer zone?
Okay, we're going to talk about the mass transfer zone and why it exists in a minute. Okay, I just want you to understand the ideal case, which never exists in practice, but it's a good concept to have to understand these slides that are up here. So the ideal case is we've got this perfectly vertical wavefront that leaves. Okay, and we'll call the time for this when this occurs. So you start your packed bed at time zero. At some time, you see the sudden step up. That step up is theta b, or the breakthrough time. And that's the time taken for this wavefront to move from the beginning of the bed to the end of the bed, is theta b, where you see nothing and then you suddenly see something. Now we can calculate that wavefront velocity.
That's when you can no longer absorb anything else.
Right.
So you have CA, concentration CA coming up before that.
No, before that you get nothing coming out because everything that's coming in is being adsorbed onto the bed. So this first region of the bed is fully adsorbed. There's no more capacity for it to adsorb on. So it moves to the next section of the bed until it finds empty spaces to adsorb on. Once you've adsorbed onto the entire bed, there's no more capacity, and then you see the sudden square shape jump up. So this is the ideal situation. And that wave front moves at a velocity which we call L divided by theta b. So the length of the bed divided by the time taken to get to breakthrough is the wave front velocity. Yes, Josh.
If there is stuff being absorbed as it goes through, how do concentrations stay the same at the end?
So what's leaving here at the outlet, if you plotted this over time, you're seeing nothing, and you're seeing something. Why do we see nothing? You're asking why do we see nothing over here?
Yeah, because we're saying it gets faster CAF because the adsorbent has is like packed, right? It's absorbed a lot already.
Right.
So if it's being if it's constantly absorbing stuff, wouldn't the concentration be increasing?
Okay, so there's this period of time, which we call theta b, where what if you were standing out here measuring the concentration of A leaving, you'd see no A leaving. Because all of A coming in is being adsorbed somewhere on the bed. Okay, so let's say at a particular point in time over here, so at that point in time, this is what the bed looks like. There's this wavefront over here. So you've got a portion of the bed, which we will call LUB, length of unused bed. There's a length at the end of the bed that's unused. This adsorbent is fresh. It's got capacity to take up A still. So as time progresses, LUB becomes shorter and shorter and shorter. Okay? So LUB becomes shorter. What do we call this section over here? We call this LES. So this region that's being used up, we call LES, length of equilibrium section. So that's on two slides down, you can see those definitions, so I won't write them up here. But LES is length of equilibrium section, LUB is length of unused bed, and we would expect then that L, the total length of the bed, is LES plus LUB. So at some point in time, this length of equilibrium section gets larger and larger, LUB gets smaller and smaller, and what you see leaving is a sudden step up from nothing to something.
So if there's ever still LUB remaining, you'll never see the jump to CAF.
As long as you've got unused bed LUB remaining, yes, you're not going to see anything leaving.
So basically, the concentration gets absorbed towards the wall of the pipe?
It gets absorbed everywhere in the pipe. So this is a packed bed, it's a cylindrical pipe. So everywhere inside, everywhere to the left of this line is used up. So that, we call this length of equilibrium section. Why do we say equilibrium section?
Because adsorption and desorption are happening in equilibrium.
Okay. So anywhere to the left of this line is in equilibrium. CAS and CA are in equilibrium in that zone. So it's important to understand then that LES, we can go use our isotherm CA, and this is CAS, and we will be on that isotherm somewhere. Where are we going to be on that isotherm? At which point? I've got to be somewhere on this horizontal axis, and I've got to be somewhere on this vertical axis so that I land up on this curve. Where am I going to be? Am I here at zero? Am I here at where it plateaus? Yeah.
Wouldn't it be at the maximum value because it's absorbed as much as it possibly can of A?
So like whatever this maximum of this curve is?
Yeah.
Yes? No? Right?
It depends on what this CAF is.
It will depend on where CAF is. So if CAF is here, let's say,
it should be like at a...
Okay. So if CAF is over there, I'm going to be wherever CAF is. If CAF were here, for example, then my CAS in that equilibrium section is over there. Why am I where CAF is? You want to explain?
Because as you feed in, as it gets absorbed, it will drop. You're feeding fresh at that, so keep on feeding. Like, if you think the wave comes full, if you see that at one end and see it at the other, you have to see it in the middle.
Okay. So in this equilibrium section, this pit section of the bed is used up. This adsorbent is fully consumed. Essentially what it is this material flowing in is doing nothing. It just keeps on flowing. So in other words, it's still at flowing at flow rate QF. It's still at concentration CAF. So all of this concentration here in the bulk phase is at CAF. And it's in equilibrium with the bed. So the concentration loaded onto that adsorbent is whatever value we read over here on this horizontal axis. Oh, sorry, on the vertical axis. So, but that CAS axis, let's say I'm at this point for CAF, let me ignore that one so that we don't, let's just consider one case. So here's my CAF. I'll read up and across, and that value of CAS we will call CAS E. It's the value of CAS in equilibrium with my feed. So this is the point on my isotherm where I'm operating at. The portion of the bed that's being used up, or LES. The LES section of the bed, we're operating at that particular point on the isotherm.
Sorry, I'm just a little confused. When you did that example with the batch absorbers,
because that concentration that was left was the concentration surrounding the solid. So if you think of your adsorbent, it's a solid particle, the material adsorbing on it. There's this fluid phase around it. Okay, this is the concentration in the fluid phase, and this is CAS, is the concentration of the solid. It's exactly the same thing. In the packed bed, in this region of the bed, the fluid that's surrounding that solid has concentration CAF. Okay, because you're feeding material in here, nothing is happening to it. It cannot adsorb. There's no more capacity for it to be absorbed onto the adsorbent. So this concentration here, 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 anywhere in this region is CAF. And then anything beyond that, there's no CAF. The last section of the bed is totally unused. This last section of the bed is doing nothing.
So it's like air is totally removed at the first section.
Yeah, this is the ideal case, right? This line is totally vertical. Okay, we're going to now move to the real case, which that line isn't vertical. But you have to understand the ideal case in order to understand what's up here on the slides.
You have like a carrier for your species that you want to absorb.
Yeah.
Your carrier would slowly pass through.
Carrier moves through.
Yeah.
On the isotherm, where it plateaus, is that just telling us that the adsorbent has like more capacity, so it could handle a greater CAF? If we had a greater CAF, it could actually absorb even more so?
Absolutely right. So this is, the fact that this is down here and not up here means I can use this bed and feed it at a stronger concentration, at a different CAF. I could pick a different CAF over here, for example, and then come up here, and I'd be able to absorb a different value.
But then wouldn't that mean that it's not at equilibrium yet because it can still adsorb more, or?
So adsorption on a bed when it's in equilibrium means that it's adsorbing and desorbing. Adsorption is proportional to the amount present in the fluid. So if this is at a low concentration, the driving force to move onto the adsorbent is lower.
Okay.
If it's over here, the driving force is higher with greater concentration difference. Okay, that's the whole principle of understanding that equilibrium isotherm last time. Okay, so that's the theoretical idealization that you should have in mind. Now let's take a look at reality. In reality, we don't have a square shape, or step function, I should say, coming through. What we rather see, if you are standing here at the end of the bed, watching and measuring CA over time, you wouldn't see that step function, you would rather see what you see here in the notes on the next slide in this section over here. This is what you would see coming through the bed. So let's add that here. You're measuring CA, and over time, so time is theta in this notation, over time you'd see nothing, and then you'd see a gradual rise, and then it plateaus out to CAF. Again now, this point where it just starts to move up is what we call the breakthrough time. So that's theta B, the breakthrough time. When it just starts to increase to a detectable level. Initially, you cannot detect any CA. When it goes up, theta B, that's when you say this is time to stop using the packed bed. Right? Because right now, at theta B, you've got material that's breaking through at the exit higher than desired, so you need to stop using the packed bed. That's when you close the valve to feed the packed bed and you switch it to being regenerated. Okay. Let's take a look at what happens inside the packed bed under non-ideal situations. So under non-ideal situations, let's go back to the beginning. Had the capacity or the capability to measure the concentration of A on the adsorbent. Now that's almost impossible. But it means that you're able to take a sample of the adsorbent from the packed bed while it's operating and then measure how much A is adsorbed onto that. That's not possible in most cases. But if you were able to do that, what you will see in the packed bed is that through the length of the bed, so this is 0 to L. So notice this is length of the bed on this horizontal axis, so it's not time. Length of the bed is what's on the left-hand side, time is on the right-hand side plot. So if we're looking at it versus bed length, you would see this pattern where the adsorbent is loaded up, and then at the unused section of the bed, it's got no A adsorbed. This region of the bed has no A adsorbed. This is what we call our unused bed. This region of the bed that has been used up is the equilibrium zone. Okay, so this region is totally used up. And this region is totally unused. But we've got this zone in the middle that we call our mass transfer zone, MTZ. Why do we have that instead of, last time recall we had this sort of step function occurring? Why do we have more of this S shape, or Z shape if you want to call it? Why do we have that instead of the square shape?
It's not going to close the radial, it's going to go through the plates and the brain.
Okay, so there's going to be some channeling in the bed. Your packed bed isn't packed uniformly. Some parts are going to present less resistance, other parts present more resistance to the flow of the fluid through the packed bed. Every particle and adsorbent in that packed bed isn't uniform either. So your adsorbent that you purchased, not all of it is going to be the same capacity. So there's ineuniformities there in your bed.
On that actual wavefront, it's still moving.
This wavefront, this shape, moves through over time. This is one snapshot. If I redrew this diagram at some later point in time, you will see this exact shape with that exact curvature just shifted over. Okay. So take that, copy, paste it, shift it down, and move it across, and you'll get that exact same shape. So that's the key thing, is that that wavefront is assumed to maintain its shape. It's a non-uniform wavefront, but it maintains its shape and just shifts down. That's the difference between figure B and figure C, you're asking. This is at time theta, this is at time theta plus some small amount. These two curves look identical, just shifted over a little bit. Okay. doubts, questions, comments?
You said you measured the time of stock by when you see the breakthrough. How fast does that breakthrough happen? Because one of our other courses won't break down, like, instantaneously to see it happen, like, but you can't control it.
Okay. So breakthrough, it depends on the bed itself and adsorbent. So here, we're going to run the bed for a period of time. When are you going to see breakthrough? Is that, we call that theta B. At time theta B, let's say you could freeze the bed at that moment. What would the profile of CAS look like in the bed at that particular moment in time? Okay. The answer's over here. So here's the snapshot of the bed at time theta B, this entry K, the corresponding snapshot of CAS at that moment in time is take this wavefront and shift it so that that tip is just at the exit of the reactor. Now I want to just come back to one point. This is called the MTZ, mass transfer zone. Why is it called that? Why might it be called MTZ?
That's exactly what's happening. You're transferring the mass of your species that you want, your desired species, into the absorber.
Exactly right. So in this zone, that is where A is moving from the fluid phase onto the solid surface. In this zone, there's no mass transfer occurring. This bed is in equilibrium. Whatever mass is moving onto the adsorbent is moving off it at an equal rate. So there's no net mass transfer. In this unused zone, there's no need for any mass transfer because there's no A available to transfer onto and off the adsorbent. But an MTZ is a zone in your reactor where there's continual mass transfer from the liquid phase or the vapor phase onto the solid.
So in the totally used section, the concentration is CASE.
CASE. Yeah.
So if that concentration is different than CAF, what happens to that difference in concentration? Where is
it? Okay. The key point is you cannot compare CASE to CAF. These two axes are very different units. This vertical axis is units of grams of A per gram of solid, or per gram of adsorbent. This horizontal axis is units of grams of A per meter cubed of fluid. So you cannot compare those two concentrations, and you cannot even convert from one to the other. They just, one is referring to A adsorbed, the other is referring to A in the fluid phase. So they're not comparable. Yeah. Mind blowing yet?
Sorry, no. Okay, so if your CAS equilibrium is the concentration of your adsorbent, or your A in your adsorbent in the totally used section, right?
CASE.
Yes.
Yeah.
So whatever mass was absorbed should be equal to the total mass
accumulated. Right, so up to that point, if you accumulated the mass coming in, so CAF times QF, that's the amount that's been absorbed.
Why do you need the bucket just to the point? They don't understand why.
Well, because you don't know what you, so yes, that's the amount absorbed, but until you know CA, you don't know where it is, right? Also, more what I'm trying, like that question is not something you would typically consider. What we're looking at here is simply understanding the patterns and the wavefronts through the adsorber. Because what we're going to be interested in is when we size our adsorber, we want to know how long it needs to be. Okay, and to do that, we need to know how much gets used up and how quickly it takes to get used up. So let's see what happens after theta B. So we've just broken through. If you keep on operating the bed, now normally at this point you would just shut it down when you start to see this concentration rise up, you shut the bed down, but if you choose to keep operating it, you'll keep going to a point which we call theta S, and I'll refine that in a minute, and then if you keep operating further still, you've essentially used up all the bed, and you reach CAF.
back to the previous insert. So it makes sense to get a bed that completely stops at the end of the empty Z. Or does it make sense to like, get a bed that has like plenty of space? So, like, if we're going to get a bed, does it make any sense to get anyone that has unused?
No, okay, so we're not, you can't choose to buy a bed with a certain amount of used and unused space. This is simply what happens for a given bed. You go, the way that we do this is we do an experiment, see how much bed gets used up, how fast it gets used, and that's just it, right? And then you size the reactor accordingly. The next example will actually show you how we do that. Okay? What I want you just to understand is where these zones are. So this is the totally used, this is totally unused, and there's this region, MTZ here, through which transfer is occurring. Now what we'll do is, being engineers, we kind of give 50-50 split. If we want to calculate what LES is versus LUB, we simply go and do the following. Cut this in half at that 50% point and call this LES and call this LUB. So our length of unused bed then is cuts through where that mass transfer zone is, and length of equilibrium section is at this 50% point of the MTZ.
Do you assume like a certain curvature? Does it really matter, like how long your mass transfer zone is? Is that different for different systems?
Yeah, it's different for how you pack the bed, for the nature of the particle size distribution of the adsorbent, for all effects what MTZ is, and how that shape is. So ideally what you want is, based on our discussion prior, is you want this curve to be as steep as possible. Because you can see now, this is why I want you to see the ideal case versus the real case, is that the wider the spread is, the less of the bed you're going to have available to use. You're wasting this adsorbent. The sharper you can make that curve, the more economical you're going to be, and more of your adsorbent you can use up.
So that's the orientation of the unit, because you have first two.
Yeah, absolutely it does. So we'll always put these units going from feeding from bottom to top. And so in fact, a few slides on, I show that here with this diagram. This is how these units are always oriented, is so we feed from the bottom to top so that we get that wavefront as uniform as possible. So you avoid any channeling and as much non-uniformity as possible. But just for illustration purposes and to plot these diagrams compactly on the same slide, we'll put them on the bottom. Okay, so where we are here with this diagram is, let's take a look now at, there's just a different picture of the same thing, so I won't go through that again. It's just a different description of it. What I'd like you to think is for a minute, what does, if you could plot LES and LUB versus time, what would they look like? So what I mean by that is, if I could plot time, and time zero here is just when I start to use that reactor, or pack bed I should say. At time zero, LES is equal to zero. Okay. So LES is equal to zero. And LUB is equal to L. So here's LUB and that is equal to L. So with time, what's going to happen to these two curves? Okay, straight lines, curved lines. Let's in particular add on the point theta b here. So if I plot LUB over time, is it going to meet? There is zero. In other words, should this slope go and hit there? Should I have drawn it steeper down? You can absolutely have a minute to push it.
Pass by the breakthrough point because you set the definition of LED halfway through your MPZ, but the breakthrough is going to happen before that halfway point.
Okay, so it's not going to hit there at zero. The definition of LED is that at the breakthrough time, so let's go back to this diagram, at theta B, so if we look at illustration K tells you what that bed looks like at time theta B. So CAS is over there. LUV and LES don't meet up at zero. Okay, so at time theta B, LUV is going to have some amount here, some capacity remaining. Let's call that delta. And LES is going to be such that this rises up. It should be a straight line. And in fact, there will be the same of delta value over here. And this adds up to terrible illustration. Okay, those two amounts should be the same.
So, it only happens when the tail ended up on the space, because it's the end of the channel, so then why doesn't it just hit zero at...
Because the definition for where LES and LUV meet is somewhere over here.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so there is some small amount of the bed that's unused. So LEV is equal to length of unused bed. There is still some tail amount on the bed there that's not used, that adsorbent isn't fully used up. So let me just take this illustration here on the board and redraw it at time theta B for you. So at time theta B, that's what the bed looks like. And the boundary between LES and LUV is this line over here. So that amount is LES, and this amount here is delta.
So is
beta
S when we do that?
Okay, so delta is that amount remaining at time theta B.
Yeah, but so in this case, we're assuming we want the fluid at A.
In this case, you want A to be adsorbed as much as possible.
So why we just use the whole bed and we get that A in the whole saturated in the bed?
Okay, because if we keep going, we're going to get A leaving at the end of the reactor or at the end of the packed bed. And our aim is A is usually an impurity like hydrogen sulfide. You don't want any of that.
Okay, so assume we have a recycling system, we can just use the whole bed.
Even if you recycle it, eventually that recycled wave is still going to come through. So the point of theta B is the point in time where you switch off your bed and you stop and you regenerate. Theta S then, theta S simply says, see this vertical green line that partitions LES from LUV? Theta S is just the moment in time when that line just leaves the reactor. Okay, so it's a fictitious time we call the stoichiometric time. We won't deal with that one too much, but our main interest is theta B.
So then if theta S, there's still a very small amount of
LED. Yeah. So that this next illustration shows what theta S is, and the final illustration shows what theta B is. Yes, Clive.
What is the flash
for
the syrup
of LED
and LES?
So at the start, when you're putting in material, your length of unused bed is capital L, as you start moving through the bed, your amount of unused bed remaining must drop off. And the two sum up to add up to L.
But that period where you have the M empty bed, that's what
oh, I see. So right initially that S hasn't just yet formed, so there is that period of time where you can conceptually.
Yeah, it
hasn't. Okay, so next class we'll do an example on this and then move on to the final section of drying and evaluating.